So good morning and welcome everybody. Firstly, I'd like to thank the Black Country Business Festival for having Creative Black Country be part of their events. And thank you for Zoe Partington, our speaker for today, for joining us. And thank you to all of you who have signed up to be part of this session today. I'd like to quickly introduce myself. My name is Rosalind Argo, and I'm the project administrator at Creative Black Country for Sandwell, Walsall, and Wolverhampton. Creative Black Country, in case some of you are not aware of what we do, we're a creative people and places project, which is funded by Arts Council England. It's Creative Black Country's aim to make the most of local talent and working with people in the area to discover, explore, and grow an exciting and meaningful program of arts activity across the Black Country. I'm going to hand over now to Zoe Partington to introduce herself and tell you a bit more about what we're doing today.
Okay, thank you, Rosalind. Welcome and hello. Great to be part of the Black Country Business Festival. I'll just explain who I am and what I do, and then I'll also explain about, the talk today is, and it is my perspective, so it's all about digitising disability, and by that, what I really mean is it's about using digital technology in very creative ways. During COVID, obviously we've all had to access different ways of connecting with each other. But I think one of the things for me is to say, you know, let's have fun doing it. Let's enjoy that experience. And I hope as I go through this, you'll begin to understand how we might think differently about doing digital interventions, really. I will start. Okay, so I'm Zoe Partington. I run a business called Partington Associates. Really, it's a creative disability action planning and training company, but it's also generated by the work of disabled artists. So it's not sort of just straightforward training or development. It's making sure that as disabled people, we are creative generators so that our experience really informs our practice. I also co-direct something called Disordinary Architecture. And again, this is about promoting activity that develops and captures models of new practice, really. And that new practice may not be new to disabled people, but it may be new to the people that access the work that we create. And as part of Parting Associates, I work with clients across the arts, in culture, heritage, the architecture sector, and in businesses to identify strategies or to ensure that your services are accessible to disabled audiences, employees, customers, and participants. And this really does mean we are disability led, and our advice and our support and all the information that we pass to you has come from an authentic voice. And I think more and more at the moment, we're beginning to realize that, and we're beginning to hear, let's talk to the people that we're trying to provide the services to. So I have a lot of experience in this. I've been doing this for 30 years. I know there's other people I've seen on the call today, participants that are also incredibly well qualified. And one of the other things I think it's worth saying is, if you don't know how to do something or how to reach disabled audiences, or you're struggling with something, you know, don't do that on your own. Don't feel isolated. Ask someone, get in touch. There's lots of us. Well, there's lots of people like me out there that are very, very happy to help. I also thought it's quite important to share with you that in a way I feel like a digital cyborg. I mean, I've got this headset on, I'm online talking to you from home, but also I have a digital insulin pump and all digital singing with bells and whistles on. My digital insulin pump connects to my sensor. I have a sensor on my body as well, which is also digital. All of that connects to my mobile phone, and that mobile phone gives me information about my glucose levels. It means I can manage myself and be really well and do all the things that in the past I would have to do, or I'd have to blood test all the time just to keep on board. But more than that, I think technology has changed quite dramatically. So one of the other things about having my digital pump is I have an alcohol setting. So if I go out, I can enjoy myself, I can feel safe. But my pump will tell my mobile phone about all the things that are happening to me while I'm out so that I can still enjoy myself and be safe. And that's a really important thing. The other thing is, and particularly during COVID, I've been able to be in touch if I needed to, directly with my diabetologist in Liverpool. So he's been able to track my glucose levels on my phone, on his phone, on his computer, and we can make and manage how I feel well, all those things that I may need to do in the background, apart from all my everyday life. And I think one of the things for mentioning this is to think, there are so many ways, there's so much technology out there. There's so much, I think I saw it when I went to the Eden Project a few years ago. They were looking at how, you know, the years ago, man on the moon had a certain amount of material and data. Now we have so much significant access to technology and resources just on our mobile phones that over the last 20 years, the increase in that significance is just amazing. And I just think every organisation could be using technology much more effectively. And I think COVID has made a huge impact on our lives. And I hope for disabled people, a very positive impact. All the conversations I'm having with other disabled people at the moment is about how this huge pandemic has highlighted the barriers disabled people have lived with every day in regard to accessing art, culture, heritage, shopping, you name it. It's one of those conversations we've been having. And it's also been interesting to look at which providers have really taken that on properly and responsibly, and begun to think about accessibility. And when we're thinking about digital connections, it can even be, you know, shopping. I know of blind or partially sighted people that during this pandemic have had to change where they shop because suddenly a large organization has changed the data inputting system for the shopping list, and they've made it completely inaccessible to that person. So it's really important now, I think, that we all understand how these barriers manifest and how we remove them, but how we can use digital technology to make everybody's lives, well, improve those lives, really. And I really hope that you have fun with digital accessibility, but think differently about it. Take risks. If you don't try things, you're never going to know. I think this is the perfect time to do this. Be creative, employ disabled artists to try and get it right with you, generate new ways of engaging audiences. And after today, I think if the one thing that you can do is to get in touch with disabled people, disabled experts, and understand how to digitize disability and create amazing digital content for your audiences. Really don't do what you've always done. Push the boundaries. And I will speak quite specifically about things as I feel it's important to understand the layers and various means that we can be using in digital engagement. So for starters, you know, you can have conversations with your audiences through Twitter. You can begin to find out what's not working. You can begin to analyze the things that disabled people are saying out there. But at the other hand, and the other end of the spectrum, you can consider how to, for example, you know, if it's a play, how you would integrate BSL or how you would integrate audio description. How would you embed that in the performance, and which ways can you potentially begin to remove the access or the add-ons that we've all sort of we've got used to in a way? I think it's not until something changes and we do it in a different way that we realize how poor it may have been beforehand. And I am going to talk more about the social model, because I think it's really important that we begin to understand how add-ons happen all the time. And I was talking to Rosalind at the beginning of this. We were talking about using Zoom. So there's only a certain amount of digital platforms for running workshops, doing presentations, having those live discussions that are accessible to disabled people across the wide spectrum of disabled people. And one of those things is because software developers have not always understood or been aware of the way that they could create accessible systems for us to use. So a lot of organizations tend to start having to adapt, put bolt-ons to make the system accessible. There's an awful lot of things that Zoom could do to improve accessibility. I mean, just reading the chat rooms, the function buttons, all of these can be quite difficult if you're blind or partially sighted. So I've said before, you know, let's have chats with your audiences. Let's start thinking about what are those fundamental intellectual flaws? How can we make the bolt-ons and access issues? How can we remove these? How can we make it part of our DNA? We need to consider it from the start of a project. And I'm saying that because it's one of those things that, you know, you set up a project and then suddenly you think, oh no, disabled people need to be part of this. But we need to start thinking about this at the end. Disabled people are excluded and marginalised communities quite regularly, and we really need to begin to identify why, how and who, and what are the solutions. To live and breathe a different way of doing things, you need to understand why accessibility has been an add-on. It's a good idea to sort of immerse yourself in things like disability arts as well. And I'll speak very briefly about this because all of these things you could spend a day in a workshop finding more about. But we have such a short amount of time. But really, in short, disability arts evolved alongside the social model of disability. It uses the experience of being a disabled person to inform the art that's produced. It challenges barriers, it unashamedly and celebrates difference and disabled identity. A key principle of disability arts is that being a disabled person is a source of pride, innovation, and fuels creativity. And this is the bit that I think is really important. It is that fueling creativity. So it's working with disabled artists within your organisation, even across your digital teams, to start thinking slightly differently about how you may engage those audiences, those customers, those participants in workshops. Sometimes some of the simplest solutions probably cost the least amount of money, but it's having that conversation with the disabled person. Because often we can think, or we can avoid doing things because we're thinking about the budget, we're thinking it's going to cost too much money. And one of those issues, well, again, is to refer back to conversations I've had with Rosalind at Creative Black Country, is around things like, and we know this, the disabled community knows this, if everyone learned British Sign Language in schools, we wouldn't have the need to have interpreters for performances and for events. We could use British Sign Language, you could all communicate together. It would completely change the system. So I think it's thinking about these things. And both the social model and the practice of disability art present robust challenges to the common perceptions of disabled people. And disabled people are often seen as tragic, needy, and unable to communicate effectively and usefully to society. But slogans from the disabled people's rights movements are really about being proud, angry and strong, and about rights and not charity, and about rights and choices. And I think these things are really important. But I also think, and I work with a blind person that's technically he's absolutely incredible. If I can't access something, I will ring him to find out how to do it. He was one of the people that really, it must have been over 10 years ago, just said to me, Zoe, why aren't you using Twitter? Twitter is so accessible to blind or partially sighted people. I'll set you up, I'll get you online. So I think it's that sort of thing where we still think about what we're doing to disabled people, not let's get disabled people at the table, in the centre, working with us to change practice. So I think one of the things is after the talk, please go and find, I don't mind, radically different disabled artists that may be able to support your company, or a disabled producer, to see how they do things differently. Find out from a disability-led organisation what sort of skills you could transfer and share. You know, let's find out how they're making their performances accessible to all disabled people. I think one of the things that's also interesting to know that I think it's in November this year, the BBC will be showcasing a drama which is about two activists, Barbara Lisicki and Alan Holdsworth, that set up DAN, the Direct Action Network. I think getting to understand a little bit more about disability heritage and disability history is really important, because at that time they were fighting for just for things like accessibility to transport. And now much more, you know, transport is much more accessible. There's still a long way to go. There's still a lot of things that can be done, but it is commonplace. And I think we need to start thinking about that across digital engagement as well. So I'll start by talking about highlighting the social model of disability, and really that is a way of thinking about society and the way we live in society. It's a model instigated by Professor Vic Finkelstein and Mike Oliver and a group of disabled people in the 80s. Vic Finkelstein came over from South Africa, where he had been an anti-apartheid protester. He was expelled from South Africa because of his actions over there, which were obviously against the government and against apartheid. When he got to the UK, he looked around, and he was a disabled person, was Vic, and felt that we had an apartheid going on here, but it was against disabled people. Disabled people had separate schools, had separate transport, had separate housing. They didn't mix with the mainstream population. He wanted to understand why, and he wanted to look at how we might resolve that in some way. He put an advert in a newspaper and asked other disabled people interested to get together and try and explore why our society operated in the way that it did. A group of disabled people subsequently got together and came up with the social model of disability. But to understand the social model, you have to understand the medical model, which was their analysis of the current situation and the way that society currently organized itself. Under the medical model, you have this term normal, and that normal person has an average height with standard intelligence. They have all their limbs, they can see and they can hear. They have full mobility. They have a normal look about them. But society under the medical model had been designed around that ideal of normal. So if you think of all the heights of all the things that are designed around people having a standard height, steps are designed, everything is designed to fit around everyone who is that average model. We also need to look at technology in this way, because that is another thing that is being used and developed in that way. Under the medical model, anyone who doesn't fit under that model, under the normal model, what we then have to do is to cure them and make them normal. And that might involve operations. That might involve breaking somebody's legs to straighten them, to make them look more normal. That might mean fixing their sight or their hearing. And if you can't do any of that, if you can't cure someone under the medical model, the other solution is to care for them. And I think this is quite an important issue, because what we want to do with digital engagement is to make people have independent access. It's not to have another person you have to ask to help you engage with that digital thing, because the system isn't in place. So under the medical model, the problem of disability is the individual's problem. It's their problem if they can't see or hear. It is their problem if they can't walk or if they have different learning needs. But what the social model says is that everyone is normal, no matter what your height, no matter how many limbs you operate, whether you can see or hear or not. It recognises that everyone has different ways of learning and everyone has different educational requirements. There is no normal under the social model, except that we are all normal. The social model says under this model, society has been traditionally designed around the medical model. And under the social model, we have to redesign society. Under the social model, the problem of disability is not the individual problems, it's society's problem. So the solution to disability under the social model is to redesign society to include us all. So to recognize the construction of society, that everyone has different heights. So to design things differently, look at handrails, where you place them, look at lift buttons, look at these things differently. Look at digital access and engagement to performances or services online through alternative communication methods or transcripts or audio description, for example. And just to say, because I don't know if everybody knows, audio description is when you use words to convey visual information. And it began in the theatre. We are giving a resource list for people to find out more things after this event, because obviously there's so much to talk about that we can't do it all today. So it's thinking about these alternative communication models. Under the social model, society should design itself to include everyone and not exclude anyone differently. That's partly in physical and structural design, but also in technology, in information, in education, in our health services, but also to design and include software to make it accessible. But also we're talking about attitudinal design and procedural design, the way you do things, the way you think about things. So people that are designing the digital content or the digital platforms or the social media programs or the marketing side or the digital workshop, they need to be aware of the things that may need to change to make sure that you can include more people. I'll just give some examples just so that you can begin to think about how that might manifest itself within your organization. So one example, a wheelchair user wants to go to the next floor and get into the building. Under the medical model, it's their fault. They can't use the stairs. Under the social model, the problem is the building's problem. It doesn't have a lift. So I'm just trying to explain this in very sort of simple terms. But there are different layers within this, and it's thinking about them within your own organisation. Example number two, a British Sign Language user wants to access a cultural talk, and under the medical model, this is their problem because they can't hear. Under the social model, the cultural institution didn't plan or consider using a BSL interpreter simultaneously for the talk. But also you can also use transcription. Not everyone uses BSL that's hard of hearing. The emphasis under the social model is about the organisation delivering the talk in a different way or offering that opportunity for people to access it. Now we know because of the systems that have been built, so Zoom, YouTube, some of those systems are still quite difficult for including accessibility. So sometimes we're having to look at alternative ways of making sure we can provide that. So we're going to talk about how adopting the social model as an organisation can have a massive impact on the way that the organisation thinks about a whole range of things. An example of this is the work I did with an advisory team at the Wellcome Trust. Accepting the social model impacted across their marketing and PR and across their social media and their contact with the press. I think it's really important because sometimes some organisations may well have an access expert on their team, but other people don't necessarily have so much information. So if you're launching a new exhibition or a new show or new performance, you also want your PR teams to be up to date with the social model language, with the way that we might term when we talk about disabled people, we talk about accessibility. If you've got maybe if you've got a grey eye theatre company coming to your performance venue and the whole performance is British Sign Language is part of it and it's based within it, you may want to think about how you may sell this in a different way to audiences. Adopting the social model impacts across marketing and PR, as I said, but you also need to think about recruiting staff and the services it offers. For example, in a recruitment selection, often questions are put in about things like, can you drive? Sometimes these things are quite unnecessary. It may be that you may put into the job description, you will need to travel. Because if you know about things like access to work, if you're a blind person, you can't drive, you can get a driver funded by the government through the Access to Work scheme, which enables you to get to wherever you need to get. So I think we need to think about some of the artificial barriers that we put in place when we're designing our services. I'm going to mention a disabled person who I do actually admire, who understands and can explain about quite succinctly about training and in talks with about digitising accessibility. Some of you may have heard about her, some of you may have been touchy with her, but she's Alison Smith, and we'll also put her information on the resources. Alison's been working in this field for quite a long time, so she's quite up to date on the types of things that may need to change. There are many other people who can help you and your organisation as well to manage digital accessibility, but this will be provided later in the literature that we provide. So moving forward, what will make a difference? I think the differences we are talking about are that you are prepared to listen and understand that disabled people cannot always access your services. And unless you do some research and ask questions to find out, you will prevent people from accessing your digital content, the programs, your online information, your websites, your social media, your products, your heritage and your culture. So I think step one is about, and I've sort of said it, but it's about understanding the social model of disability, and it's to understand the gaps in your provision by undertaking something which we call an equalities impact assessment. I mean, in basic terms, this is a needs analysis of your audiences and your participants and their requirements. This is an analysis, if digital, about how you will make it accessible or available in various alternative formats. One of the things about doing a survey is you have to make that survey accessible as well, because often I've seen people will do a survey or they'll do questionnaires, but those particular surveys and questions are inaccessible in themselves. So you don't actually get the true information. You don't get everybody's insights in what could change, what could be improved, and how would we look at this. And I think, well, in business terms, I think this is now called survival deviation. So if you always look at the things that you do well and try and improve those, you'll be, you know, successful. But I think we need to look at this thing called survival deviation. And that, and the example I was given for that within a business setting was to look at things like during the wartime when Spitfires came back, and the Spitfires that came back that were damaged, where the bullet holes had hit the aeroplanes, they looked at those aeroplanes and they put particular strengthening, you know, metal plates to try and improve and protect those planes. What they didn't do straight away is to think about which planes hadn't come back and why hadn't they come back. So this thing about survival deviation is trying to find out about the things that you don't know. If you start to look at the things you don't know, you can start to improve your services massively. So what they realized was that a lot of the Spitfires that didn't return, it was the fuel tanks. They'd been hit. Obviously, the plane blew up, fell to pieces, and those people didn't return, and the plane didn't return. So they then looked at basically improving the metal plates around the fuel tanks, which actually changed. More planes came back. So I think you've always got to start thinking about what is it that we don't know? How will we find that out? And who will we get to help us do that? So this will then lead, I think, once you've found out the things that might not be working or the things that are fantastic or the things you might enhance, it's then worth thinking about the Equalities Diversity Inclusion Action Plan. Now, you may well have a specialist area, and I think anyone that's an MPO for Arts Council will be having these discussions, but it's a plan about digital content, digital engagement for all those audiences. And it's really important to have these in place. I think it gives you the opportunity to look at what are the realistic priorities that you can manage, who will do that, how will you make that happen? What budgets can you allocate to this? If you allocate budgets across this, you will sort of, in a sense, it goes back to that normalizing it, isn't it? It won't be an add-on every time an access feature needs to be put into your art, into your cultural, into your products. So all those things need to be built in from the beginning. So the basics of finding out about the access needs of your audiences or customers are participants, are key to providing the right accessibility. I'm not going to spend hours expanding on guidance or about how you might make Twitter accessible or Instagram or any of these other platforms, or how you might make your show accessible. There is an awful lot of literature and information out there, and we don't have time to do that. But there are courses, there are online courses, there are workshops. There are all sorts of opportunities to enable you to think differently and get this right. And I think it's crucial to understand and have discourse with your audiences, your customers, your participants and your artists. And you probably know this, but it may be asking questions in a different way. It may be bringing a disabled expert in to be able to ask those questions with you. It's just trying to think about it and in a slightly different way. But it's also about the business and the organisation taking on the responsibility to do that and being inclusive and feeling welcoming. You can tell your customers or your participants or your audiences, this is what you're trying to do. You welcome feedback. But I think it's about structuring it. It's about finding out how this can influence your long-term plans. There are a range of access needs we need to consider. Accessibility is quite wide. It's not just about blind people accessing your performance or services. There is quite a lot of government information, and I can also put that on the resources. But I think it's worth thinking about some examples, because sometimes I think we forget about certain groups of disabled people, and then they're excluded from our plans. So it is about meeting the needs of everyone, and also just thinking about, you know, there are, you know, we have a quite a mature population. That aging population is increasing. Those people are going to need different sorts of access things, solutions put in. So it's also about thinking about all of these people. Some of those people won't think about themselves as disabled people. And I think one of the things sometimes is not to think about disabled people as the issue or the problem, which is what I talked about the medical model and the social model. It's thinking about if we improve our services, it will probably improve our services for all sorts of people, not just disabled people. So for older people, for people that may have been excluded in other ways. I mean, even down to some people find looking at screens very difficult and get very tired, very lethargic. I did actually notice on the government website, they've listed quite a lot of different conditions and different impairments. But I think people with more sort of medicalized conditions or ME or other things, they're not really listed there. And I think one of the things that some research that's happened over the last 6 months is that for some people, if you record the performances, record the workshops, record the talks, they could watch them at another time. And it might be because they're unwell when the event is going on. It might be that they have to have medical interventions at that time and they can't necessarily access it at that time. There's a whole variety of reasons. It may well be nothing to do with disability, maybe parents managing their children. It may be that someone's managing an elderly relative. So I think the more we can make this wider and welcoming to everyone, the better it is. So I'll just give a very, you know, some examples, but I think what would be a good idea is to think about these examples and think about what the solutions might be. So for example of people with visual impairments, you know, I'm colorblind. I cannot perceive the difference between some colors. I have low vision and need to increase the text size in my browser. I can tell you now, Zoom, the text size on Zoom is a nightmare. It's really difficult if you're blind or partially sighted. I have low vision and need to use a screen magnifier to make things bigger and cannot read text that has poor contrast. I am blind and I use a screen reader. I am deafblind and I use a braille device. It's really useful to know about some of these things. And I'm not saying you need to know about somebody's condition, but you need to know what their access requirements are and to ask people what their access requirements are. So it may be that they need very good color and contrast. It may be that they need bold text. It may be that they need an audio file. You don't really need to go into the medical terminology of each single part of their impairment. You need to know what it is would improve the accessibility for them accessing your services. So, for example, people with auditory impairments, you know, I'm hard of hearing and struggle to hear most things. I'm deaf. I use British Sign Language as my first language. I find English hard to read and write. And I think it's important that we think about, you know, in performances that we think about it. So even if you're writing a play, you know, how often do we sit down with deaf artists or deaf producers or deaf artistic directors and begin from BSL as opposed to beginning from English language? And when I've worked with companies like Sign Dance Collective, when I've seen their performances, I mean, artistically, it's stunning. This is where, you know, the creative generators from starting from difference make a huge impact on the artistic integrity and the content that comes out. And I saw one of their performances, this was Sign Dance Collective. They use digital technology, so they projected the words onto the back of the screen. You could have it on your mobile phone, you could have it on your iPad, but they also use different languages. So they used Welsh, they used British Sign Language using Sign Dance, and they used Spanish, and they did something called Turtle Trials. And it was about them basically saving turtles on the planet, but a young show for young children. But what was incredible was it didn't really seem to matter which language they were using. You got it. It made sense because the drama and the physicality of it and the music and the sound, it just all came together. And I just thought it was one of the most stunning things I've ever seen. And I really wish we could start to engage in that way much more with digital technology, the things that we're doing. Another example, people with cognitive impairments, you know, I have dyslexia and I struggle to process written text. I'm on the autistic spectrum and I have literal understanding of text. I have attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, ADHD, and I find it hard to concentrate. I have a learning difficulty and I need things to be simpler and I need to be able to understand them. My memory's not good as it used to be, and I get easily confused. This is where things like recording things, pre-recording things, sharing that information afterwards is fantastic, because you know, if you've forgotten what you saw, you want to go back over it. We've got the digital technology to do that. It doesn't cost that much to do that. You know, there's even a button on Zoom where you can record and share things. So also example of, you know, people with speech impairments. I have a speech impairment and struggle to communicate my speech. I am much more confident and reflective when using text-based communication. This is really important for things like ticketing. So I know sometimes now you can do online ticketing, but just to think about if you're phoning up and getting your tickets, if that's not possible for you, you're constantly having to engage other people and you don't have as much independence. Example of people with seizures disorders. I have epilepsy and my seizures can be triggered by flashing contents, by flashing lights. I think many organisations now seem to recognise this and will advertise if there, you know, if there's bangs, there's lights, there's flashing, there's things going on within that performance or online. But again, and in galleries, in museums, it's really important that, I think the thing that's quite important is to know. So it's about transparency. And I think, you know, even now, it's very difficult to know, for people to be honest about accessibility within their venue, within their programming. I think if we were more used to explaining, you know, what we know is accessible, which events you can come to, how, I think it's the, and how, if something isn't accessible, for that organisation to take the responsibility to say, we are going to make it accessible, we're working on this, please work with us. So I think it's about, it's knowing. So if I want to book an accessible venue, somewhere in the West Midlands for to put an exhibition on, I'd like to know who provides, you know, the best venue. Is there parking? Is there accessible toilets? Is the cafe good? What are the acoustics like? What's the wayfinding like? What's the signage like? And it's the same on a website. You know, if you're trying to access information on a website, how accessible is your website? Have you looked at it? Have you started to talk to people about whether they can use it? So there's so many layers of different things that, not just within a building, but within digital content and digital platforms as well. So it's really thinking about, you know, can disabled people use your services? Can they use the things that you've currently got? Can they use them in an unsupported way? Can they use your call center or your, you know, what about the face-to-face support, which is probably via Zoom now? Can they use your ticketing services? Are your performances available online? Are they available after the event? How about your workshops? What do you use to make sure that your workshops are accessible? How have you thought about planning? There's also this thing, there's another layer here as well, is about making sure that disabled people are part of what you do. So what do I mean by that? So if you're putting on talks, are disabled people part of that programming? Are they there talking about their artwork, talking about how they access things, talking about how they deliver their art? So I think there's all sorts of things about the digital content, because when I found this, particularly when we were working at the Wellcome Trust on the new exhibition Being Human, it was about making sure that the stories of disabled people within the exhibition artifacts that they had within that museum setting, that the stories from disabled people were all there as well. And I think with the new exhibition that Wellcome did, they really tried, and the curators really tried to change the way that the exhibition was interpreted online, also within the physical venue, but also by using digital technology within the exhibition space itself. So having audio files available, having films available, having sign language available, having transcripts available on those films. There's a whole load of things that need to be built into all sorts of different things, which does improve accessibility. And there's another thing where people talk about assisted digital. Not everyone will be able to use your service unsupported. Some people will lack the digital skills, the trust, the confidence, the kit, the equipment, or even the data. And I think I've seen it in with Creative Scotland and with the Film Scotland and things. They've started to look at programming events, but they've been thinking about this, really this issue about digital engagement and poverty, about how, you know, can people afford to access your events? How have we thought about that? And they've started to provide data available for people to be able to access the performances. So I really think there's other things around accessibility that we need to be talking about in an everyday way as well, about how do we make sure those people on the poverty line have access to those cultural events, particularly now, because I think, you know, we've got the situation, aren't we, where a lot of people have begun to, their salaries, they've got lower, the wages are lower, they've lost their jobs. We need those people still be part and parcel of society and enjoying themselves and having some opportunity to access culture. So, I mean, accessibility also depends on the situation. It's not something that is either, you know, a true or false. It can only be measured in relation to a specific situation or scenario. But something can be something that can be accessible to some people can be inaccessible to other people. So I think sometimes people talk, within architecture, we talk about this as the conflicts in the streetscape. So shared spaces may be fantastic for wheelchair users or for people with mobility impairments because we remove the curbs. But for blind and partially sighted people, it can be very quite a distressing, unstable place because you suddenly don't know where the edge of the highway is. I think it's the same with digital information. We need to think about how much content is available online, how many access solutions are put into one performance. Often, if you get sensory overload or other things, we need to think about, and it is conversations with disabled people and testing things, how we might improve that and how we can work together. I've seen many people developing apps as well for cultural and businesses. And for example, I saw a heritage tour around a gallery and a building arts venue. I mean, you can have these apps now. As you know, some people will. You can have a wayfinding app. You can have a heritage, a tour app. There's all sorts of ways that these can be used really well. And I ended up working on a project across 5 or 6 different museums and galleries. Where we're really trying to encourage them to use IT, digital technology in new ways. But quite a few of the, well, some of the fundamental issues, the things that people get wrong, is to not include disabled people, even in the design and the development of the software. So they created an app, which ideally was for blind people to use in this setting at the castle. And they didn't really think about, because the person producing it hadn't really thought about accessibility, they set up a system where you could gain information about heritage on the site and you could go to a certain point and get that information, download it, have access to all sorts of information, which is fantastic. But the way they designed the system through the, say, the blind person using their mobile phone, the buttons weren't tagged with the right information. So they didn't, it was a bit hit and miss. They didn't know where to go or how to get the right information. And I think in that example, and this is why I say work with disabled experts, if you're developing an app or something in that way, start working with disabled experts from the very beginning. Don't do it halfway through. Don't do it as a bolt-on or an add-on. That's very medical model. Try and get it embedded from the very beginning. It's really important. And I'm probably emphasizing it quite a lot because a lot of people don't do it. I think it's really important to know that. And I think you can see that in sometimes in website design. So you, if you're redoing your website, if you're developing it, find out what's not working, find out from behind the scenes how the web designer has put graphically put it together, it may be inaccessible to quite a lot of people. It's really important to start asking those questions. And when you're commissioning people, build that into the commissioning brief. So make sure that accessibility is built into that brief. You don't necessarily need to know about accessibility at that level yourself, but you need to make sure the people you employ or the people that produce the services or the people that you're engaging to make it work for all your audiences have some concept of that and have worked on things. And you can see what they've done before. You can find out from those disabled users. So I think one of the other things I want to talk about is to, and there's many things that we could talk about, so hopefully some lots of questions will be asked later on. I think during this time, people have started to do a little bit of research, and I've talked to some organisations about that research. And one of the things that we're beginning to find is that the most used platforms have been Zoom and YouTube. And really they've been used, those two platforms have been used because respondents have found them the most accessible platforms to use. This may be really important information if you are putting on a workshop and want to use a platform. I think it's really important as well to find out that some platforms are more accessible to some disabled people than other platforms. So it's useful to begin to investigate this. One of the other things, and I've talked about it quite a lot, is about the aspects of live streamed events. So if you're putting on a live streamed event, and I think when we've asked people about how important it is to have a live streamed event with audio description, between 62 and 73% of respondents have really thought that the audio description is really high up there on the agenda. Having large images, so if you're putting an event on, and I will talk about the in a moment about an event called Slow Looking, if you're using Zoom, you can have you can still have a live event. You can also advertise an image or an object in your gallery or in your collection. You can do an event and a workshop and bring disabled people together, or blind or partially sighted people for this example. And you can have large images. You can share those large images on Zoom. You can also share the digital content beforehand of the audio description of those images, so the information about the visual. But one of the things to do is to also do that live. And the importance of doing it live is that people can ask questions. So if something's not clear, they can ask questions. The best events I've seen are when the curator and the audio describer work together as a team, and people can ask those questions at the end. It may seem a really obvious thing to say, but I think it's really important to try and build those things in. One of the other things that people have been saying is the opportunity to socialize for participants is really important. So even in an online event, you know, try and build in some opportunity for people to connect with each other. Sometimes that can be through questions and answers. Sometimes that can be in breakout rooms. Sometimes that can be through workshops. I mean, I've been myself, I've attended four different workshops by a theatre company in the north called Engage to Engage. And they've put on a Shakespeare workshop, they've put on a creative writing workshop, they've put on a dance workshop, and they've put on a clowning workshop. They've thought about accessibility within each one of those workshops. So each presenter that's delivering those workshops has understood about using audio description to communicate to blind or partially sighted participants that are attending those workshops. The Shakespeare workshop was, they started that process by a tour, a virtual tour of the Globe Theatre, and a conversation about moving through that space, what that space meant, how it was designed, what it looked like, describing that space. All these things are really, really significant, because often as a disabled person, I mean, in the physical scenario, you can end up at the theatre. You may get a fantastic audio described performance. You may get a fantastic signed performance. But what's forgotten about is it's the charm of those theatres, the charm of those arts venues. You don't get any information once you get through the door about the architecture, about the building, about the space. We can use technology to engage people in this now. And I think it's really important to think about your venue, the technology you might use to explain, you know, the wayfinding in the venue, how your venue, what it looks like, where the exciting bits are, where the relevant things that are useful to people are. But all of this can, this is a time, I think, to play and get it right and get involved in all of this. One of the other things that came up was about the optimum length for a live stream event. And people were saying about an hour. And I think that's if it's a one-to-one, an audio description workshop, all those type of events. After that sort of time, people are beginning to get tired. One of the other things that came up as well is that 85% of people indicated that they would like or be very likely to listen to a recording if they couldn't make an event, or even if they had been, so that they can listen again. So I think one of the things that we have found is that if you record an event, it's easier sometimes to make it accessible. It's not ideal, but you can still make it accessible after the event, because sometimes live events can be it can be complicated. I'm being realistic about this. But I think if you can provide an alternative that at least people aren't missing out. They still have that opportunity to be engaged. I think 45% of people agreed or strongly agreed that online events would mean they can still engage with culture, and they will do that much more often, because I think during COVID, people have begun to use the internet, Wi-Fi, accessing things a lot more. And I think it's really important, because a lot of organisations, you know, a lot of things happen in central hubs. If you live in a rural community, you can't necessarily get to a workshop and an event at 6 o'clock at night. So I think this is where we can be using digital technology, digital interface, digital platforms, capturing things so that other people can be involved that may not be in those hubs where things are happening. I think one of the other things that people talked about was is this idea of the publicity. So how do you find out if an event is accessible? Who tells you? Where is that information? And I think one of those things is to begin put it on your website, put it on your events, tell the ticketing teams, sharing that information, having lists of disabled people, particularly if it's in your locality, about what their access requirements may be, if they're happy to do that, really, so they don't have to keep telling you every time they ring up. I think it's really important to try and that we all take responsibility, that disabled people don't have to keep telling you, keep explaining, keep asking. I think this is, you know, a really, really important scenario. So I'm sort of thinking about now about examples about many organisations are thinking differently about making their services available to disabled people. But one of my favourite events, and I was just talking about it before, was something called the Photography Gallery in London put on during this year. And it was called Slow Looking. And it was looking at a series of photographs from different photojournalists from around the world. And I was fortunate enough to look at the work of Hannah Morales and her photojournalism. She's from the Philippines. And one of the things that the curator set up was to have, I was given the image, the photographs. So I was given three photographs, and to work with her on developing a really interesting audio description and context about each one of those images. So then each one of those images, we wrote it up, we shared it, we worked together to try and open it up for blind or partially sighted audiences and other audiences that would find it useful. And then we basically recorded that onto audio files. And at the time I was using my iPhone to do that. I was using the memo section on the iPhone. It still provided quite clear content, which they could then drop onto their website that people could access either before the event, after the event, or even during. But one of the other things I did was that script that we'd used, I would deliver that live as part of the event. So we would show three photographs. People would on Zoom, would dial in, we would all connect. They would listen to those audio descriptions of each photo, and then they would have the opportunity to ask questions. So it became, it was quite a social scenario as well, but it also became really useful for people to ask those questions. But I think there were several layers going on in there which made the event much more accessible to disabled people, much more open and welcoming. And it was open to everyone. It wasn't specifically just open for disabled people. I've talked about the some of these things, but I think one of the things that might be useful to go over, because I'm just looking at the time, is about the types of things which I've said, but I just want to remind you, it is about doing research. So these are sort of tips, really. Do your research, find out what makes a good service accessible, find out what design, if it's a website, is it accessible? What are the range of access needs that are required for people to be able to access your site? Have you undertaken any equality training? This is really useful. It's probably not the first thing you think about, but if you are providing services, looking at disability action plans, I talked about it a bit at the beginning, but it's understanding the social model, it's understanding disability heritage, it's understanding how disabled people may use things. And I think often training can help towards thinking differently about how you may plan your services or how you may structure your new strategies really for making sure that disabled people can access things. It's also knowing your legal requirements. You know, it was sort of under the Disability Discrimination Act, but now it's really under the Equalities Act. I'm not necessarily saying you need to know reams and reams about those acts, because sometimes it's not always helpful, the guidance and the legislation. It can still, you're not being creative, I think, when you're using an act or you're using that type of guidance. I think have those conversations with disabled people, find out what would work much better. But by doing that, you will actually be covering that legislation, making sure your services are accessible. So again, consult with local disabled people and deaf people about the current provision, the events, the sites. Is there a local disability group or charitable organisation or service available that you can talk to? Think about organisations like Disability Arts Online, which is UK globally wide. Think about advertising your events with them. For us in this locality, it's in the sort of Black Country area, the Shropshire, the Birmingham. There's other organisations, there's disability-led organisations that you could be talking to. And I even know at Disability Arts Online, they do deliver courses on using the Otter app, on using which basic transcribes, if someone's doing a talk, it will transcribe it so you can read that text on at the same time as the conversation going on. They offer that training because it's a very low cost. It costs about £100 a year to have the Otter app. And if you know how to use it, you can be using it and trialing it and testing it. One of the other things is to be thinking about budget requirements and user testing. I've said it several times, but I think the user testing, finding out what your products are like, how people are accessing them. If you're using websites, make sure you're meeting the minimum standards. There are worldwide accessible guidelines on how to do this, but there are lots of people you can talk to who could very quickly have a quick scan over your site and let you know where the issues, the problems are. Make sure they're employing web designers who know what they're doing and have a good track record of incorporating accessibility and working to budgets. If they don't understand, make sure that they have training, maybe mentor or team them up with a disabled person that does know what they're doing in this type of scenario. Also be aware that all disabled people, they're not just one homogenous group. All access needs are not the same. There are things that cross that will make sense to all sorts of people, but I think people are different, like everybody's different. There are different ways that people access things. I think it's useful to know that. Again, incorporate usability testing with disabled and deaf people. Maybe get a particular group that you work with regularly to trial things, to test things out. I know when I used to sit on the access group at the Hippodrome in Birmingham, it was a fantastic group. It was a whole mixture of different disabled people that went to their performances regularly, could give really positive feedback, could talk about the things that didn't work. But also on that access group at the Hippodrome, they also had different staff members from different parts of the teams within the organisation. So it wasn't just a group of disabled people sitting around moaning about what didn't work or what did work. It was also the staff were there to find out what worked or how they might do things in a different way. So I think it's also about people being together and having those conversations and that discourse. We've just talked about, be creative. Don't be dull in incorporating disability access. You know, using digital technology, making sure things are accessible for disabled people, it can be exciting. You know, make it, bring it to life, make it sexy, make it stunning, make it interesting. I remember this is from an architecture perspective. I remember, gosh, it was probably about 12 years ago, going to the Royal Institute of British Architects Library, their bookshop, and trying to find a book on inclusive architecture that was exciting, that was vibrant, that was powerful, that was intuitive. There was nothing. It was all about NHS settings. It was all about this medical approach to designing accessibility. Or it was information from non-disabled people, really, that were access auditors trying to make access, improve it for disabled people. But it wasn't. There wasn't one nub of creative flair in much of that I ever looked at. That's changing, it's getting better. But again, I think it's let's make it joyous, let's make it fun. I think this is really, really important. So I think, I'm going back, I think I'm just sort of repeating, but I just want to make sure that people think about an impact assessment. It can be small or large. It doesn't have to be, you know, the biggest comprehensive thing you've ever done. You can start in a small way, you can start to change all sorts of things, but make sure you're speaking to disabled people. Research and development. Go and find out what other people are doing. Go and find out what the disability-led organisations are doing to make their work accessible. Talk to Grey Eye, talk to Canduco, talk to all these companies that are out there. See whether they will come and work with you. Ask them, get advice. Make sure you have a budget. Develop your plans, your accessibility plans, your disability accessibility plans. Use SMART objectives, decide who is responsible, by what date and how it will happen. Get that list of priority things in order. Monitor and evaluate. And I'm saying that again, and I do say it with architects as well. If you don't monitor and evaluate what you've produced, you're never going to improve it. I think it's really important to think about this. An evaluation should be at the beginning and the middle at the end, not just after it's happened. Really important to try and build that in quite regularly. And then one of the final things is, and I've said it before, enjoy it. Make sure you have fun. And remember, 1 in 6 people are disabled, and at least 20% of websites and services are inaccessible to disabled people. And I know from talking to lots of other people that have investigated this, that is billions of pounds of lost business or income, or it can be. So really start thinking differently about how you might include those people to make things more available so that you can also, as organisations, gain from those audiences. So that's, are we okay there? I'll just, you've heard a lot of me talking. I think it might be a good idea to... Are we going to have a break, Rosalind? Is that the...
Yes, thank you very much, Zoe. No, that was brilliant. Thank you. Yes, everybody, if we'd like to reconvene at 22, so if that's all right, I mean, have enough time for questions with Zoe. If anybody has a question, feel free to put it in the chat, but I will open it out if you're happy to put your screens on and raise your hands and things. But if we come back at... Is 22 enough time for you, Zoe? Would you like a little...
Oh, yeah, that's fine. I've got everything here. Yeah.
Okay. All right. See you all back at 20 to 12. Hello, everybody, if you are back. it's hard to see with everybody's screens turned off. But just got a few comments for you, Zoe, in the chat from Paul Dark, who unfortunately had to leave at 1:45. He said, excellent, Zoe. See you again one day soon, an excellent on UK activist thing. And Heather, thanks very much, very informative. I don't have a question at the moment, but I'm still... That's great, Heather. Thanks for staying with us. Hopefully we'll have some questions from other people.
Thanks, Rosalind. Does everyone have to just do the answers on there, Rosalind? Is that how it works? Sorry.
No, well, if people... I've got one question. So the first one's from Adrian. If you would like to ask it, Adrian, that's absolutely fine, but I can ask it for you if you wish. Are there ways to make Zoom more accessible for deaf and or hearing impaired?
Shall I just answer?
Yeah, that's fine.
I mean, other people on here may well know more about this. I think for those specific questions, let's ask deaf people. There are things that you can do, and it's getting that more detailed information, I think, from those deaf people that are using it all the time, or the interpreters that are using it all the time. I'll put that on the resources list so people can find out more information about how to do that. So I think it's that there are different ways of tweaking it that can actually help.
Great, thank you. Has anyone else got any questions? Feel free, you can either put your screen on and raise your hand if you wish, or if you would like to put it in the chat, I can ask it on your behalf. Emma Dacre, I've got a question for you, Zoe. With regards to access groups, It's something Emma's been thinking about for a while, but has not actioned. What kind of fee is advised?
Hi, Emma. Just trying to think that through. It depends. It depends what you want that action group to do, really. If they're involved with you as an organisation consistently, or is it project based? I mean, I would have thought. I mean, you need to be covering people's time. You need to be covering their transport costs if that is impacting on them. Working at the welcome, well, this will probably shock you now, Emma. Working at the Welcome Trust, because I was part of a university program with RCMG at Leicester Universities, we were advising as experts to welcome. And I think they had 4 days of my time as part of the Being Human exhibition. I think they quite quickly realized if they needed more days of our time, and that was programmed in. And in that particular scenario, we were there as disabled experts. So we were paid, you know, a fee like everybody else would get, between £300 and £500 a day. I think if you've got an access group that's working with you consistently and very local, it's about it being a two way. So what can you give back apart from cash that person would value? I mean, just simply thinking about more disabled people being on the boards of organisations is how do you work two way with those people? So I don't, it's a hard one to answer, really. I think you'd have to think that through.
I think Emma would like to respond to you, Zoe.
Okay.
Yeah. Hi, Zoe. Thanks for that. It's, as you know, we work quite, we have quite a varied range of projects at Craftspace, that are all bespoke as well. So I've thought about it a lot with the exhibitions, but then there's all our events as well. So I suppose I was thinking of something more consistent, local based, that might work across our project. It's obviously something we need to think about.
Yeah, I mean, I think, well, it's up to you, but I mean, for example, I mean, I've talked to Arts Council about it. You know, maybe there should be, having a disabled person as a mentor to an organisation or to a team is incredibly useful, I think. But again, you want a range of disabled people, I know, because issues can be very different. Maybe look at an annual fee that you talk to that person about, and they would then work with you on specific things. I think you just have to start having conversations with people, really.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Thanks.
I think one of the things, it's important that you've said that though, actually, because one of the things that's important is disabled people who expect to do things for free.
Yeah, that's what I'm really conscious of not doing.
And that has been a very regular thing, which disabled people are beginning, as they're becoming more, getting into employment, having careers, having more opportunities, they're beginning to realise it's not right that you should be used in that way and not valued. And it's the value thing that's the important thing.
Yeah.
As a disabled person, do you feel valued? And one of the other things that happens, and I think this is around evaluation and monitoring and things, people are asked things about what doesn't work and then it's not acted on. And I think then those disabled people that are offering their advice, particularly if it's for free, feel very devalued.
Mm. Yeah, that's a really important point. Thanks.
Yeah. And sorry, just to say as well, I think it may not be that you can put that full access provision in, and that may be because it's a budget constraint, it may be a real issue, but I think it's meeting people halfway at least, I think.
Well, it's a communication then, isn't it? It's being transparent about what you're doing or not doing and why. Okay, thank you.
If I could just add something, I'm Michelle Clare. I'm not going to show you myself because I've got a gun on the wall, and it's not very, very PC because I'm working from my front room. I'm from Dudley Council, and obviously it's not very PC to go around showing a gun, but it's my front room.
Is it Smith & Weston, I would ask?
It's a very good replica, and it belonged to my parents, so I don't feel inclined to take it down. But when I'm normally doing Teams things, obviously I've got a very PC replica of Liso's Park, but I can't show that on Zoom. This is the first Zoom thing I've done, so I'm not quite sure how to work it. So what I would just like to share with you that a few years ago, I did, because I've always bought the cards off the mouth and foot art paintists. I invited them because I have, as I explained to Rosalind, I have a sight disability myself.
Right.
And I've got Fuchs dysfunction. Basically, my corneas are wearing out. And so I invited these painters to a church fete. I was working with this church who want to turn their sort of auditorium, I suppose you could call it. They want to turn it into an artistic community hub. And so I invited two of these painters along to this disenfranchised community. There was no other way I could describe this congregation. It was a case of, this is my church pew and don't you dare sit in it. When I first went to do my presentation, I talk about, you know, feeling alienated. It was hard to believe I was in a church of God. And so anyway, these artists turned up, and because it was a Victorian church, the disabled access was literally a piece of plank of wood you threw down at the back of the church. And fortunately, there was four of us to hold this piece of wood in place to get this one disabled person, severely disabled because he'd broken his neck in a car accident. And anyway, it took four of us to hold his wheelchair up. But he did actually a bit later on say that we could use his experience to enable the church to get enough support for a proper wheelchair access at the front of the church. Anyway, I sort of stood there, as you do as a regeneration officer, thinking, oh my word, have I made the biggest mistake of my life, inviting these obviously very talented but vulnerable people into this very hostile experience. And they started to do their wonderful painting with their mouths. And all of a sudden, these very hostile people started to take these artists a cup of tea and a piece of cake. And well, of course, the one person could only breathe occasionally. That was the only thing he could do for himself, and paint. And then all of a sudden they decided to actually purchase some of the wonderful works that these artists were doing. And I stood back and I breathed a sigh of relief and I thought, phew, yes, it has worked out. And the interaction between the disabled people and the able-bodied people, it was just absolutely fantastic. And the amount of work that those disabled people picked up that day, it was just unbelievable. And they were invited back on several occasions to different functions that the church held. And it just worked. It was absolutely fantastic. And needless to say, 3 years down the line, the church actually got its disabled ramp. So, you know, it was just wonderful. So I'd just like to share that with you, that, you know, disability does sometimes bring its bonuses. So I just thought that was, you know, useful.
No, I think that is, Michelle. And I think disabled people are used to having bad experiences, sadly, and they're used to things being not thought through. And I think one of the things is that we all need to work together to try and stop that, really, and to change that. And to make somebody, you know, just, and also to stop being surprised if a disabled person can do something as well as someone else. I think it's really important that we just value people, look at their skills, look at the hidden depths that we don't know about because we put barriers in the way, because we prevent people from having those opportunities. So I think that, you know, it's a really good example. But it's about opening it up more, isn't it? And it's about planning. It is about planning and sharing and thinking things through. And that situation about the people realise disabled people are human beings and that, you know, they're real people that we should all be engaging with all the time.
Yes.
I think nobody, if I'm honest, nobody sets out to exclude a disabled person on purpose. But that is what happens. No one designs a building on purpose to exclude a disabled person. No one puts a website together to exclude a disabled person. No one puts a cafe environment in without an accessible toilet on purpose. But we have to rethink, we have to think about what needs to be in there and remind ourselves about what we don't know, and that it's important sometimes to dig a bit deeper. So thank you.
Yeah, and I think from my own point of view, when you've got a disability that people cannot see, that is one of the worst things. I mean, a few months ago, I went to a meeting and they hadn't made provision for people with weird eyes, shall we say, and I couldn't see what I was supposed to see. They'd done it in size font 4 and there was no way I could see it. I need to have something about size 16. And they all sat in the room and they started to laugh. And I sat there thinking, am I in a building in the 21st century? And I just couldn't believe it, you know. But hey ho, you know.
I think that's where, I mean, this is why I really enjoy disability arts, and I hope some of you will if you access it. That, you know, the work by Dolly Sen, the really interesting things. I think she created, I think it was the charity funding box, and collecting money for the normals, as she put it. So I think sometimes you have to be a bit radical and a bit juxtapose things, I suppose, and begin to get people to see that the way that they're behaving or the way that society has constructed things is not acceptable anymore. And there is a great shift happening at the moment, I think, across all different cultural groups. But I think I used to attend meetings and make do and manage. I think now I just say, I'm sorry, I'm not, you know, you'll have to set a new meeting up. It's not accessible to me. You'll have to change it. But it's quite hard when you're newly diagnosed, say, with an impairment, to be that strong and vocal. But I do think that's where we need to work together. Disabled people shouldn't be the only people putting accessibility in. We need to make sure that everybody around you is doing that. Otherwise, you're the one lone voice consistently saying it, and then people stop listening because they think you moan all the time. Or you stop going. You stop going because you just get fed up with it.
Or you're the one in the team, as some people in my team say, well, of course, you're the one with the strange eyes, aren't you? You know, and I sit there thinking, rrr. Yes.
Well, they quite clearly need training.
thank you, Michelle. That's been great to have your input. Zoe, I'm very aware that we're getting close to 12 o'clock. And I've got another question from Hannah at... Okay. Opera Company. Hannah, would you like to ask a question to Zoe?
Oh, sorry, Rosalind, could you say which company was it again?
Oh, Birmingham Opera Company.
Oh, okay. Yep.
Hi Zoe, hi everyone.
Hi.
I just wanted to ask something. I totally take on board your point, Zoe, that disabled people aren't one homogenous group, and access kind of covers a really broad range of factors. So do you have any tips for how we prioritise or think about which steps to take first? Because even if our ambition in the long term is to make all of our work accessible to everybody all the time, mm-hmm. Realistically, we kind of can't do everything at once. So how should we go about prioritising and deciding what we do first?
I think you need to work with someone, Hannah, that you know, like my, well, not necessarily me, but other people that are consistently working on disability action plans or strategic plans around diversity and inclusion, to look at which element of those you can do, you know, in year one, year two, year three, which one of those elements are those priorities. I just think you'll have to sit down with someone really, Hannah, and go through it to think, how do we... And I think it is, you know, we have to be realistic, don't we, about what we can do within budgets, constraints and human resources as well. But I think you'll probably know which things are impacting most of the time. I'd get somebody in to work with you, Hannah, on it, and to get some really big flip charts out and work it all out.
Okay. Thank you.
I know that's not answered your question, but I think you've just got to keep working at it, really.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you, Zoe. We're a couple of minutes from 12 o'clock and I understand that people probably have other engagements for their day and things like that. So I would just like to take this opportunity to thank you, Zoe, again for being our speaker today. It's been really great having you and just giving us more information about how to make the arts and culture accessible for all. Thank you, everyone, for attending and signing up. I hope you've enjoyed the session. Zoe, as she's been saying throughout, has got a resource document that she'll be passing on to me, and I will get that sent out to everybody. If I could also ask you before you leave to complete the feedback survey, as you know, we just really want to know what you thought of the session, and it'd be great to know what we can maybe do in future with the Black Country Business Festival. But yes, thank you all for attending, and I hope you enjoy the rest of your day.